Now let's talk about the various kind of compensations which are available, what this whole compensation is all about. Now there is direct compensation and there is indirect compensation. When we say direct compensation, so wages, salaries, commissions, bonuses and gain sharing all form the part of direct compensation. So if the person is working, he is getting directly paid. Now there could be indirect way of paying as well, which is typically a non-financial sort of thing, or let's say tangible sort of benefit which is provided to a person. So how is that done? It is more to do with the motivation or retention of the employee, and it could be that the person could be given certain vacations, that is, you know, you a paid leave kind of concept. And in organization there is this concept that you can actually encash certain those, you know, if you do not avail those leaves, you get cash when you try and kind of encash it at the end of a certain period. Then there could be breaks. It could be like the company might say that, okay, there is a provision of sabbatical. There is something called a study leave. There could be this maternity leave. All these kind of breaks are a part of compensation. Again, being an employee, the employee gets entitled to these sort of breaks. Of course, holidays, like the national holidays are there, earmarked. But then there are other sort of leaves as well, which are provided, like casual leave, sick leave, so on and so forth. Then there are certain insurance plans which are given to the employee in a form of compensation only, which is medical, dental, life, whatever. So this is a kind of thing which is covering the employee's life. So the health of the employee, the expenses are covered under such kind of insurance plan, but it is not directly being paid to the employee. But yes, his life, his health, it is all covered under certain policy, wherein the premium of that insurance plan or policy may be borne by the company itself. Now, then there are certain pension schemes like employee pension scheme, like, you know, this provident fund. So these kind of security plans are also there, where a part of the direct salary or the wage is invested on behalf of employee in the name of the employee. And till the time the person is in employment of that organization, the employer continuously contributes to this kind of security plan. Then employee services are there, which is again a part of the compensation, but it could a non-financial way of compensating the employee. Like there could be some kind of educational assistance, there could be some kind of recreational programs. There are companies who have these guest houses wherein an employee can go and stay there in a marginal sort of thing, because it is all subsidized. There are club memberships, there are employee discounts which are given when if a person is working in a certain organization, so on and so forth, right? Now let's discuss what are the various equity issues and how we can address these equity issues. That was the first and foremost purpose of compensation planning, that there has to be this equity, and this equity has to be ensured amongst the employees. So the main concern is that one should be equated for the efforts the person is putting in. The employee who's working for something should feel happy or should feel motivated enough to put in his best abilities if he is being equated as per what he thinks his efforts are. Second, that the people around him who are working in a similar fashion, the kind of role he has, the kind of task responsibility the employee has, and if there is anyone else who is doing a similar sort of job, he or she should be again equally paid. That is one major issue which is there. And the third thing is the external equity, which is that the industry, wherever the similar sort of job is being done with a similar knowledge, abilities and skill set, then there should be some equality out there, some parity of pay out there. How can we ensure this kind of thing? What are the various methodologies to address equity issues? First and the foremost is your salary surveys. Now, then comes your job evaluation and analysis, which is evaluating the jobs and all. Then through performance appraisals and incentive pay, we can try and equalize these things, or we can address these issues of equalizing person's effort. So if the person thinks that during an year, the performance year, he has done good or he has not done good, according to that, his salary or his compensation can be adjusted. And he can be given incentives if he has performed better, so that this sort of equity issue can be addressed. And the last is the communication grievance mechanism and employee participation. So let's say if there is any issue regarding this sort of equity, that an employee might think that I am not being paid well, or the other person has been paid more than what I am getting kind of problem is there, it can always be resolved by having that sort of a grievance mechanism available within the organization, and it can be sorted out and employees can participate in doing that sort of a thing, coming to some kind of solution. So first of all, let's talk about the pay surveys. What are pay surveys? They collect data about compensation paid to employees by all employers in a particular, maybe geographical area, maybe in an industry or an occupational group. So depending on whatever is your data, sample size data, we can have that comparison that, okay, North India, the salaries are generally high, or we can say the manufacturing sectors is paying to managerial level at a certain levels. The increments have been at a certain particular level. And the occupational group, we can say that, okay, the blue collar workers are being paid this much, or we can say the chartered accountants are being paid, the fresh chartered accountants are being paid this much. So we can have a survey regarding that particular occupational group. Now moving on to the next part, which are what are the various sources for these kind of salary surveys. Lawyer self-conducted surveys, consulting firms, professional associations, government agencies, and the internet. Now moving on to job evaluation. Now to evaluate a certain job, that means what is the value of that particular job any employee is performing, we use the following methodologies: job ranking, classification of jobs, point system, and factor comparison. Now, in this particular job evaluation process, we need to focus on the skills of required for the job. These are the compensable factors, basically. The effort required in the job, the responsibility, and the working conditions. These are the main factors which one needs to consider if the job has to be evaluated. So let's look into all these various methods of job evaluation. First of all, talking about ranking of jobs. Now, ranking of jobs is the most simplest of all. It is simply, as the name goes, that you rank the job according to the most simplest of all, to the most challenging jobs in an organization. For that purpose, our job analysis and the specification, they come handy. We will take that what kind of educational levels, what kind of working condition, what kind of skill and experience is required. And basis that, we can simply rank them in that order. But then if the organization is large and there are complex jobs in that organization, then this would not be very effective. It only works when there is kind of a small business or it is a simple kind of organization, then this ranking of job methodology is workable. One can able to group the jobs and then rank them as well. Similar kind of jobs can be grouped together. And then basis those groups of job, you can have those compensable factors, which would be skills required, as I said, education, so on and so forth. Right? But then again, it is the least frequently used methods of all. Coming to the next method is qualification or grading system. Classification or grading groups are a set of jobs. So we can put them in a certain classification, which are sets of jobs put together. And then they are ranked by difficulty or sophistication involved in that job. Basis ranking on compensable factors such as judgment, qualification, difficulty, originality, and experience, making grade definition. So basis all these things, all these compensable factors, the jobs are grouped together, the sets are made or they are classified together, and then they are being ranked. The evaluator first decides how many classifications the job structure has to be broken into, and then definitions are written for each class. After the classes are defined, jobs are compared with the definition and placed into proper classification. So this example would be making this particular thing much more clearer. For example, the class 1, computer work, no managerial responsibility. So now we have this compensable factors out here is what is the responsibility and what is the kind of job involved. So there is computer work which is involved and there is no managerial responsibility. Then we are now classifying it basis whatever clusters we have made. The second classification is computer work, no managerial responsibility and team involvement. Third is computer work of medium complexity, no managerial responsibility and team responsibility. Fourth classification is computer work of medium complexity, managerial responsibility is there and team authority is there.
Class 5, complex computer work, managerial responsibility, and team leadership. So you see, we are ranking these or grouping these particular set of jobs together. And then basis that, we are giving them a classification from the most simplest one to the most difficult one. So this is what classification or grading system of job, how they are evaluated. Basis this classification, then we can have the value of compensation against each kind of group of jobs. Maybe basis the market system, whatever the market is paying. Or we can, if it is a new job, which is some new industry, which something which has come up for the first time. For example, the mobile industry, all of a sudden the technology was required. So where do you think all across, how would that those jobs would have been evaluated? There must have been some system which had been put in place to understand what is the worth of that person who can make some, let's say, programs or software for those mobile technologies or apps and all. I'm talking of some 20 years back. It was still at a nascent stage. It was something very new. So this kind of system may have been used to evaluate what is that job worth. And today, because we have so many of the same kind of people existing in that industry, telecom and mobile industry, so we can easily use that salary survey and start paying the employee when we hire that kind of employee. But just imagine a scenario when this sort of job is created for a first time. Point system, that's the third popular system by which we evaluate jobs. It is one of the commonly used systems, yes. And in this particular system, how the job is evaluated, it is, first of all, we identify compensable factors, assign weights to them, and calculate the net worth of the job. Now, all these, let's say, the compensable factors right here is education, experience, complexity of job. It's just an example, relationship with others, working condition. Now, basis this, there is a certain weightage which has been assigned for each category of a job. Let's say there is this first job, second job, and third job, so on so forth. In that particular, let's say, first job, education, we have given the points, let's say 50 points to the education. That is the kind of requirement of education in that job one. Or then in job two, requirement of education is somewhere which we can say we have given 100 points, and so on so forth. Experience required is, again, we have given certain points. And basis that, we will calculate what are the total worth, the total points each job gets. So when these are summed up, the job has been evaluated. And according to the points, each job, job 1, job 2, job 3, job 4, job 5, we can say that this is more important, or this is, we can pay more to the job which has more points, so on and so forth. So typically what we are doing, the evaluators assign points on the basis of skill required, physical and mental effort required, degree of dangerous, unpleasant working conditions, and amount of responsibility. We assign points, see the weightage, and then we calculate. Now, the next similar kind of method, it is based, again, a quantitative. If you see, the first method of ranking was a qualitative method. You're simply kind of deciding on your own, which is the most simplest method and which is most complex. But now with the point method and factor comparison method, we are now using something of a quantitative approach, where we tend to put some quantities. We may try to make it more objective, because it is not a single person's job. There are a number of people involved in it. There is a committee out there. Typically, a committee is set, and that committee decides what is the various points or degrees of importance given to each job. So it becomes a slightly more objective approach, and it is, as because each factor, each compensable factor is quantified, so it is a quantitative approach for job evaluation. One of the similar methods as point methodology is factor comparison method. In that, there are a few steps involved. First of all, we take information from the job analysis. So what exactly is the job all about? Then select key benchmark jobs. So it is not possible to analyze each and every job in the organization or have this kind of factor comparison for every job. So we pick up key benchmark jobs, then rank key jobs by the factor. So again, when we say factor, we are giving certain weightage to each of the compensable factors. So what are the compensable factors? It could be skill, it could be knowledge, experience, working conditions, so on and so forth. Then we distribute wage rates by factors. So what is it that that factor is being paid in the market? What is the wage rate? So let's say if it is a particular skill, what is it that that skill is being paid in the market? And then if we consider the experience part, what is it the market is paying to a certain level of experience? So this is how we will pick up the wage rates and then assign it with the factors. Then rank key jobs according to wages assigned to each factor. Next step becomes that compare the two sets of rankings to screen out unusable key jobs. Construct the job comparison scale and then use the job comparison scale. So this is how factor comparison is done to make it a little more clearer. Now this is how it works. Rank the benchmark jobs on the basis of each compensable factors. So let's say we are considering these jobs: welder, crane operator, punch press operator, and a security guard. So there, because we have calculated on the basis of certain weightages and points and all, what are the mental requirements for each job? What are the physical requirements? These are the compensable factors now. Skill requirements, responsibility, and working condition. Right. So all these five things are the compensable factors for these jobs. Now, if you see, we have assigned certain factors, points to each of these. Let's say 1, 4, 1, 1, 2. Now, in that, we will collect the pay data for the benchmark jobs. So, basis this, we will be now taking care of these points or the factors, and then we will multiply it with the wage rate or the pay data which we have collected. For each benchmark job, allocate market pay across the compensable factors. So if market pay for a benchmark job is $15, how much of that $15 is for skill, how much is for effort, how much for responsibilities, how much for working condition? So basis this 15, you will be having this proportionate amongst this all these various compensable factors. So 15 gets divided as per this particular thing, that if this is the benchmark, let's say crane operator is the benchmark and we are paying $15 an hour or whatever. Why we are paying $15 is because of the fact that we pay, you can then, as per this weightages, you can equate it that what is the value of each of the compensation factor. Now, slot all the non-benchmark jobs into their proper places on the pay scale for each of the compensable factor, because we are just picking up initially only the key jobs in the organization. So what about the non-benchmark jobs or non-key jobs? We are then, once we have these key jobs in place, when we have evaluated the key jobs, then we can put in the non-benchmark jobs as well. Determine the pay for each job by adding up the pay from each compensable factor. Now we know, basis this previous calculation, that 15, that means it, the three parts of 15, that means somewhere around $5 is for mental requirements. So basis this kind of calculation which we have done, what we will do for the non-benchmark jobs also, we will start equating that, okay, that if this is 3.50 for the skill in that particular job, 2.5 for effort, 3.75 for responsibilities. So we get a value for something which we had not put in as a key job, but for a non-key job kind of thing, we get that, okay, instead of $15, this job is worth $11 an hour or whatever, right? So this is just an example how the factor comparison job evaluation works. Let me know if you have any queries. Stay tuned for more content.